Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents A Brief History of Korea, Isolation, War, Despotism, and Revival, The Fascinating Story of a Resilient but Divided People, by Michael J. Seth, narrated by Sean Runnette. Introduction. Away from the world's main crossroads, in the shadow of China and Japan, Korea was a land little known outside of East Asia. It was one of the last countries in the world to be visited by Westerners. The first book in English on Korea, William Griffiths's Korea, The Hermit Nation, published in 1882, was written by an American in Japan who had never been to Korea or met any Westerner who had. Long after it had been opened to the outside world, Korea seldom drew much attention. The scarcity of books on Korea testified to the lack of interest held in the West and much of the rest of the world for this peninsular land in Northeast Asia. In recent years, however, this has changed considerably. South Korea has attracted attention with its breathtakingly fast transformation from poverty to prosperity, its globally popular smartphones and other products, and its vibrant entertainment industry. And who hasn't heard about North Korea? Or doesn't recognize the image of its young dictator with a weird haircut. Yet Korea is still not very well understood by most outsiders. The existence today of two very different Koreas only adds to the challenge of comprehending this ancient land, and how different they are. South Korea is a wealthy, high-tech center of international industry and entertainment. Its people are among the world's most diligent travelers. Few countries have such a high percentage of population trotting across the globe each year. It is an open, democratic country. Indeed, one of the most democratic countries in Asia. Seoul, its capital, is a dynamic, hyper-modern city. Then there is North Korea, the world's most isolated state, the only one whose ordinary citizens are not allowed access to the World Wide Web, the one place without Coca-Cola. An impoverished society whose people suffer from high rates of malnutrition and live under what is arguably the world's least democratic, most repressive government. How did it happen that one of the world's oldest and most ethnically homogeneous states developed into such two different societies in a couple of generations? How can we explain why they are developed along paths that were not only radically different, but both very unusual? And just who are the Koreans anyway? How are they different from Chinese and Japanese? How does their story fit into the larger narrative of the history of humanity? These are a few of the questions that this book will try to address. At the same time, it presents the story of Korea, which is interesting in itself. There are many good tales in the history of this ancient land. This book will tell some of them. Shaped like a rabbit. The Geography of Korea. Korea looks small, sitting next to China and Russia on the world map, but it's not so small. It has a population of 75 million people, 50 million in South Korea and 25 million in North, making for a total somewhat larger than Britain's and a little smaller than Germany's. North Korea covers about the same area as England or New York State, while South Korea is a little smaller. In its entirety, Korea is roughly equivalent in area to Great Britain. Koreans say that their country is shaped like a rabbit, with the northeast forming the long bunny ears. It also resembles Italy in that it is mostly a long peninsula anchored to the mainland in the north by a mountainous region. The country is some 1,000 kilometers, 620 miles long, and averages about 200 kilometers, 124 miles in width. A great chain of mountains, the Taepaek Range, covers most of the northeast and runs like a spine along the eastern part of the country. The Taepaek Range has spurs. The most important of these, the Sopek Range, forms an arc separating the southeast region from the other parts of the country. The mountains are not high, reaching only 2,000 meters, 6,562 feet in South Korea, and over 2,700 meters, 8,858 feet on North Korea's border with China, but are rugged enough to hinder overland travel. Most of the country's rivers flow from this eastern spine westward into the Yellow Sea. There are no broad plains. In fact, no matter where you go in Korea, you are in sight of mountains. because it is a well-defined peninsula bordered on the north by mountains and on three sides by the sea, Korea forms a distinctive geographical area attached to, but not integrated into, the mainland of Asia. Its current borders, that is, of North and South Korea together, were formed 6 centuries ago. Since then, the end of the Korean world has been the Paektu or Baektu Mountain, a 2,744-meter, 9,003-foot volcano, and the two rivers that flow from it, the Tumen River, which heads northeast and empties into the East Sea, Sea of Japan, and the Yalu River, which flows southwest to the Yellow Sea. Despite its modest size, there is a considerable temperature range, from the long, bitter, cold winters in the northeast that would challenge the most rugged New Englander, to the milder winter on the southern coast, where it only occasionally becomes cold enough to snow. The weather changes dramatically with the seasons. In the winter, dry, cold air from Mongolia and Siberia spreads over the peninsula, often accompanied by frigid winds. In the summer, the great landmass of Asia heats up, sucking in moist air from the Pacific and thus bringing about the summer monsoons. This is when the country receives the better part of its rain. Most of the country becomes a tropical steam bath, with heavy downpours that bring only a brief respite from the heat. The arable land in Korea is limited, but fertile and well-watered. As a result, for much of its history, it has been fairly densely populated. The people are mostly concentrated in 4 rice bowls, the largest pockets of good farmland, consisting of the Naktung Basin in the southeast, in an area known as Kyungsang, the southwest area of Chola, the Han Basin near the center of the peninsula where Seoul lies, and the Daedong Basin in the north where Pyongyang, North Korea's capital, is situated. As the Naktung Basin, Chola, and most of the Han Basin are in the south, with the Daedong Basin and a small part of the Han Basin in the north, South Korea has most of the good agricultural land. The seas around Korea are rich in sea life, so fish, squid, and other ocean products have been an important part of the diet. However, Koreans are mountain people, not sea people, and have historically not been much for seafaring. This might be surprising, since few live far from the ocean, but the seas around Korea, except for the south coast, are not friendly to navigation. The east coast has good harbors, but is cut off from the populated areas by mountains. The west coast has shifting sandbars, barely immersed reefs, and some of the world's highest tides, making navigation tricky at best. In pre-modern times, immigrants came from the forests and plains of the north, high culture from China in the east, and invaders from all directions. Koreans have called themselves a shrimp among whales, meaning they are a small country surrounded by much bigger ones. These include China, which for the past 2,000 years has been the world's most populous country and one of the most territorially massive, Japan, which has historically had about 3 times Korea's population, and the vast continental empire of Russia. In earlier times, before Russia spread all the way east, the whale, to the north, was one of various nomad empires such as the Mongols and the Manchus. Furthermore, while China's northeast region of Manchuria shares the Korean border today, for most of its history this region was not Chinese, but part of the steppe and forest peopled by some of the world's most formidable warrior groups. However, China was close enough to be the source of most of Korea's ideas about government, society, art, literature, and religion. The 185-kilometer, 115-mile Korea Strait separates the peninsula from the Japanese archipelago, just wide enough to make these very different lands, but narrow enough to ensure frequent interaction. In fact, Korea has often been a bridge between Japan and the mainland. Sometimes this has meant that Korea acted as an emissary, bringing Chinese-derived culture to Japan. At others, it meant that Japan viewed Korea as its avenue to a continental empire. In any event, this is Korea, a geographically compact peninsula, fertile enough to support a large agricultural population, a land isolated enough by mountains and seas to develop its own culture and society, but also close enough to China to be powerfully influenced by it. Modest in size, it has at all times been under the threat of conquest and absorption by its powerful neighbors. Yet Korea has somehow managed to maintain its political autonomy most of the time, and its distinctive culture and identity, always. A note on romanization. The Korean writing system, called Hangul, works well for Korean, but it is difficult to convert into the Roman alphabet. Having no tones, the Korean sound system in no way resembles or sounds like Chinese. The two are completely unrelated, but it is radically different from European languages as well. The sounds are tricky. There are three different K sounds and three ch, p, and t sounds, as well as two S sounds. Furthermore, the same letter can be pronounced differently depending on the sound that precedes or follows it, so the problems multiply. For many years, there was no standard way of romanizing Korean. For example, the common names romanized as Lee, L-E-E, Yee, Y-I, and Ri, R-H-E-E, and the less common ones written Lai, L-I-E, and Ri, R-I, are all the same name. This author remembers traveling along a highway that led, according to the signs, to Sorak Mountain. But later, the road signs began to refer to Siolago Mountain. One provincial government wrote the name of this rocky, beautiful, and popular mountain in one way, the next in another. American scholars developed the McCune-Reischauer system for writing Korean in the Roman alphabet, and this gradually became the accepted practice in scholarly literature. Then in 2000, the South Korean government came up with the revised romanization system. Now writers on Korea have two systems to choose from, which presents quite a dilemma, since they can be quite different. In this book, I have chosen to use the revised romanization system, even though I have used McCune-Reischauer in my other books, in the belief that this newer system is likely to become the more common one in the near future. In some cases, when a person or thing is more widely known by a different spelling, I use that one. Chapter 1. Origins. Bears, Gods, and Mountains. The Mythical Origins of Korea. According to popular legend, Korean history began almost 5,000 years ago when the deity Wanung descended from heaven to a high mountain. There he was approached by a tigress and a she-bear who wished to become human. Wanung gave them each some sacred herbs and cloves of garlic and asked them to stay out of the sun for 100 days. The she-bear climbed into her den as requested and stayed there. But the tigress became restless and ventured out after a few days. Clearly, the she-bear was more trustworthy, and in the spring, Wanung transformed her into a woman and had intercourse with her. As the story goes, on October 3, 2333 BCE, their son Hangun founded the first Korean state, which was called Kocho-sun. The date on which Hangun's kingdom was established marks the beginning of Korean history and is still a national holiday in South Korea. Modern tradition has identified the mountain where Hangun was born as Mount Paektu, which lies on the border of Korea and China. Koreans today are proud of having 5,000 years of history. This claim is based on the founding of Hangun's kingdom, plus a generous rounding off. First recorded in the 13th century, during a time when Korea was being overrun by the Mongols, the Hangun myth has reinforced in Koreans a belief that they are an ancient and distinct people with their own history. The myth identifies what it means to be Korean, starting with their love of mountains. Mountains in Korea are sacred places where shamans still perform rituals. Important Buddhist temples are located in the mountains, so Buddhists, as well as shamanists, go off to the mountains to pray. Furthermore, almost every Buddhist temple has a shrine to Shanshin, the mountain spirit. Today, Koreans celebrate mountains mostly by climbing them. Hiking is a national pastime. Koreans are ardent hikers. No matter where one goes in Korea, there is always a mountain in sight, and a hiking trail up it not far away. The mountain associated with Hangun, Mount Paektu, Whitehead, is Korea's most sacred. Mentioned in South Korea's national anthem and depicted on North Korea's national emblem. Mount Paektu was regarded as special by the Manchus and other Northeast Asian peoples as well. It towers over the area with a small crater lake called Chunchi, Heaven Lake, at the top. The Hangun myth therefore places the origins of the Korean people at the border with Manchuria. This is not far from the historical truth, since almost all modern Koreans are at least partially descended from Manchurian tribes. The garlic that the god gave the she-bear is significant to the Korean identity as well. Koreans boast the highest per capita consumption of garlic in the world. Important as it may be, not every Korean historian began the story of his land with Hangun. Some started with the story of Kicha, a relative of the last Shang Dynasty Chinese emperor who fled to the Korean peninsula when the dynasty fell in 1122 BCE. According to this legend, it was Kicha who introduced agriculture, sericulture, silk making, literature, and all the refinements of civilization to the Korean people. He went on to rule the Korean state of Kochosan. For historians who emphasized this story, Korean history began when Koreans became civilized. Furthermore, the Kicha story linked their society with that of ancient China, which was regarded as the home of true civilization. From China flowed ideas about religion, ethics, government, law, art, and literature, and it was from China that Korea acquired literacy. In modern times, Korean nationalists were uncomfortable with the Kicha myth, since it suggested that Korean culture was derivative rather than original, and subservient to outsiders rather than independent. Hangun, by contrast, appealed to nationalists, as it supported their belief in Korea being home to a unique people with a culture older than China's. Today, Hangun is celebrated in both Koreas, as a myth and symbol in the south, and as a real historical ruler in the north, while Kicha is nearly forgotten. Yet both myths contain important elements for understanding the facts of Korean history. Hangun represents the Korean people's connection to the mountains, forests, and plains of Northeast Asia. Kicha, the enormous impact China had on shaping their culture. Cul-de-sac and springboard. Early migrations of peoples into the peninsula. Who were the first Koreans? For thousands of years, people migrated from Manchuria into the Korean peninsula. For some, the peninsula was a cul-de-sac where they settled permanently. Others took to the sea, using the peninsula as a springboard to the lush Japanese islands. The 185 kilometers, 115 miles, that separate the southern part of the peninsula from the nearest of Japan's four main islands was close enough that some people crossed the Korea Strait. DNA analysis, reinforced by archaeological evidence, indicates strong links between the ancient peoples of Korea and Japan. It is possible that some of the migrations went both ways, with people mingling on both sides of the straits. We should not think of early Korea, Japan, and the mainland of Northeast Asia as self-contained areas, but rather as places where people and cultures mixed and overlapped. The peoples who migrated into what is now Korea discovered a land nearly covered with forests that provided a rich variety of food sources, not only game animals, but also acorns, chestnuts, and edible plants, including arrowroot, turnips, onions, and wild millet. The coastal areas teemed with fish, shellfish, and squid. Pottery, which is usually associated with agricultural societies, since hunters and foragers on the move did not carry pots, appeared 10,000 years ago. Several thousand years earlier than in the Middle East or Europe. This suggests an environment with a sufficient abundance of wild plants and game to support at least a semi-sedentary population. Village life began in earnest, however, with the domestication of millet and pigs some 6,000 or 7,000 years ago, possibly as the result of Chinese influence. These were important additions to the people's diet. But the real transformation to a densely populated agricultural land began with the introduction of rice. The reign of rice, the introduction of agriculture, and the rhythms of Korean life. Korean society as we know it from historical records begins with rice cultivation. Rice is the chief staple of the Korean diet. The word for cooked rice in Korean, pap, also means meal. A Korean lunch or dinner or even breakfast consists of rice and banchan, dishes eaten with rice. Koreans ate other grains, including barley, millet, and sorghum, but these were considered only poor substitutes for rice. When there was plenty of rice at every meal, life was good. When there was not enough and one had to eat other coarse grains, or not much at all, life was hard. The most common form of rice in Korea is the short-grained, sticky japonica or sinica variety, which was probably introduced from China 4,000 years ago. It thrives in the Korean climate. Planted in the spring, it grows rapidly during the hot, humid summer monsoons and ripens in the sunny, dry weather that follows in the fall. It yields well when planted in dry fields, but yields more when transplanted into wet paddies. Small streams along the mountain and hillsides can be channeled into wet rice paddies, part of the complicated rice growing techniques that took many generations to perfect. Flat land is limited, but what is available contains nutrient-rich alluvium that rice and other crops thrive in. As yields increased, more people could be fed. This is how Korea, a small mountainous country, was able to support a fairly large population. Though the process of converting the forest to rice fields was a slow one, by 1000 BCE, agricultural villages dotted the land. Since the cultivation and cooking of rice are so basic to the rhythm of life in Korea, one could say Korean culture began around this time. These early people left no written records. We don't know what they called themselves or what language they spoke, but they did leave behind something to remember them by. Megalithic structures called dolmens. These often resembled a table with legs and a flat top, while others are reminiscent of an upside-down patuk, go set, with the pieces on the bottom and the board on the top. Koreans were not the only ones to build these stone structures. Dolmens dating from around the same time are also found in nearby parts of Manchuria and northern China, as well as in parts of Europe. No Korean megalith on the scale of Stonehenge has been found, but the numbers are amazing. More than 10,000 dolmens have been found throughout the country, far more than anywhere else in the world. Around 700 BCE, bronze came into use for making daggers, mirrors, and other objects. By 300 BCE, iron objects were being used. Such artifacts from Korea are similar in style to earlier objects found in China, suggesting both had Chinese origins. Around the same time that iron implements emerged, Chinese sources began referring to a Joseon kingdom, now called Gochoson or Old Joseon by modern historians, to distinguish it from the later Joseon dynasty that ended in 1910. This, of course, is the same state that, according to much later accounts, was founded by Hong Kun. Some assert that the name Joseon is derived from the Chinese Chaoshen, written with the character Chao meaning dawn or morning, and Shen meaning fresh or calm. This has been translated into English, with some literary license, as Land of the Morning Calm, a title bestowed upon Korea by earlier authors that still appears in tourist literature. From the Chinese perspective, Korea is to the east, near the dawn or the quiet early morning. So it has long been assumed that the Korean pronunciation of these characters was the origin of the name Joseon, also written as Joseon, which is the official name of North Korea. North Koreans call themselves Joseon Saram, or Joseon people, that is, Koreans. That name is used in South Korea as well, but not officially. Recent scholarship suggests a less colorful explanation, that the name Chaoshan, Joseon, was simply the Chinese attempt to pronounce the name of an indigenous Korean people. We know next to nothing about the early Korean state of Gochoson. We think it was centered in the Liaoning region of southern Manchuria at first, and then moved to northern Korea, with its capital, Gwangyeom, at the site of modern-day Pyongyang. Gochoson likely had only the most rudimentary structures of a state. In fact, it may have been no more than a confederation of tribes, but it did have a king. The last king of Gochoson, Wuko, who is the first historically attested figure in Korean history, appears to have blocked or tried to monopolize trade between Wudi, the Han Emperor of China, and the tribal peoples of the area, becoming such an annoyance that in 109 BCE, Wudi invaded Gochoson. The hapless Wuko facing one of the mightiest military forces of the day, was murdered by his own ministers, who then submitted to Chinese rule in 108. Thus, China entered the Korean Peninsula, and a new phase of Korean history began. Enter the Chinese. Early Chinese involvement and influence. With the arrival of the Chinese, Korean history took a major turn. From 108 BCE, parts of Korea were incorporated into the Chinese Empire. Chinese settlement and administration was located in the northeast, again centered in the vicinity of present-day Pyongyang. This area, called Leilang by the Chinese and Nangnang by the Koreans, was part of China for more than four centuries. It was a remote frontier outpost of the empire that had two main purposes. One was to promote trade with the tribal peoples of Northeast Asia, Manchuria, Korea, and even distant Japan. The other was to keep an eye on them. In addition to Chinese soldiers and officials, there were some Chinese settlers, but the population was mostly a mix of various people. From the Eastern Barbarians, as the imperial annals called the Koreans, the Chinese imported wood, fish, salt, iron, and agricultural products in exchange for porcelain, silk, jade, bronze mirrors, and other luxury goods for the tribal elites. Along with Chinese products, the Eastern Barbarians also acquired artisan skills and ideas about how to organize society. It was during this period that we can first put a name to the peoples that lived in and around Korea. According to a document from the 3rd century CE, there were 9 Eastern Barbarian peoples, meaning non-Chinese, living east of China. Among these were the Wa, in the Japanese islands, and several peoples who lived mainly in Manchuria, including the Puya, a powerful tribal federation. For Korean history, the most important of the Eastern Barbarians were the Goguryeo and the Han. The Goguryeo, a federation of warrior tribes, lived just north of Yalu River. Skilled horsemen and archers, they were culturally related to the nomads of the great Eurasian steppe, from whom they may have been descended. The Goguryeo first appear in Chinese records around 75 BCE as a group engaged in peaceful trade. However, from the 1st century CE, they began to gradually move south, raiding northern Korea and stirring up trouble for the Chinese in the process. Not surprisingly, Chinese records speak negatively of the Goguryeo, describing them as volatile, emotional, difficult, and dangerous folk. South of the great Han River, where modern Seoul sits, were the Han peoples. The Mahan, the Jinhan, and the Payonghan all spoke the same language, which is ancestral to modern Korean. Indeed, Koreans today, especially in the south, see themselves as direct descendants. Hanguk, Han country, one of the common names for Korea, is the official name of South Korea. South Koreans often call themselves Hanguk Saram, Han country people, whereas North Koreans call themselves Joseon Saram. But both terms, Joseon and Hanguk, are common names for Korea. The three Han groups were farmers who grew barley and rice, raised pigs, plowed with oxen, and lived in small villages. They had earthen homes that were half underground, making them cooler in summer and easier to warm in winter. The Chinese describe them as fond of drinking and dancing, a reputation that Korean farmers still hold. They were organized into kuo, the word for kingdom, but were only tiny chiefdoms consisting of a chief who controlled a few villages, not really states. The Mahan, the most numerous group, lived in the fertile farmlands of the southwest and were divided into 54 kuo. The Jinhan occupied the fertile upper and middle parts of the Naktong area of the southeast, and the Pyonghan, the lower Naktong basin. Both were divided into 12 kuo. Thus, the Han had settled in the two southernmost of Korea's four rice baskets, while the Chinese controlled the northern Taedong basin. The Han River basin was a sort of neutral territory. The semi-nomadic Goguryeo were on the northern fringes of Korea, and a few less numerous tribal peoples lived in the northeast. This was the situation when the Chinese Empire began to disintegrate. Like its contemporary, the Roman Empire, the mighty Han Chinese state went into decline and was overrun by barbarians, and then disintegrated. After 220 CE, the empire broke up into three kingdoms. The northernmost of these, the Wei Kingdom, reasserted its power in northern Korea in a military campaign that destroyed the Kokuria capital, lasting from 238 to 245. China was briefly reunited, but after 311, when the imperial capital of Luoyang was captured by barbarians, the empire collapsed. A smaller empire survived in the south, from the capital at Nanjing, but northern China, in the area near Korea, was taken over by a confusing number of mostly short-lived barbarian-ruled states. Only in 589 was the empire fully restored. Thus, for nearly three centuries, the Korean peninsula was without a Chinese presence, Chinese intervention, or the influence of a powerful Chinese state. These three centuries gave Koreans enough space to develop in their own way. Magic eggs and kings, from mythical chiefs to early states. After the Chinese left Korea in the 4th century, the local peoples created three major states: Goguryeo in the south, Pyeokche in the southwest, and Silla in the southeast. The three kingdoms then fought for supremacy for three centuries until Silla won and united the peninsula. Modern Koreans look back to this period as a romantic and exciting time in which the state of Silla, direct ancestor to their own country, emerged. Goguryeo was the oldest and biggest of the three kingdoms. According to tradition, it was founded in 37 BCE by Chu Meng. The legend goes that a beautiful woman, Yuwa, attracted the attention of the king of the Manchurian state of Puyo, who made her his concubine. One day she was impregnated by a sunbeam and gave birth to an egg. The king, suspicious about what might emerge from this egg, fed it to some animals, but instead of eating it, they guarded the egg until it hatched. Out came Chu Meng, a boy who proved to be a skilled archer. This is, in fact, the meaning of his name. Chu Meng's half-brothers were jealous of his skills and tried to kill him, but he mounted his horse and fled. When he came to a great river, turtles appeared and formed a footpath that only he could take, and he managed to escape, later founding the kingdom of Goguryeo. Chu Meng mania hit South Korea in 2006 and 2007 when the MBC television network aired its enormously popular 81-part Chu Meng series. The show portrayed the boy as a rather spoiled stepchild who gradually matured into a responsible person, becoming a national hero and uniting the Korean people against the oppressive rule of China. However, the public broadcaster KBS in 2010 and 2011 aired another historical drama in which Chu Meng was depicted as a tyrannical king. The truth is, we know almost nothing about him, or even whether he existed at all. Furthermore, the date the story gives for the founding of the kingdom is misleading. Goguryeo was likely a loose federation of tribal leaders that only gradually coalesced into a state, probably around the early 4th century. To return to the legend, Chu Meng had three sons. One, Yuri, was designated heir. The two others by a different wife, Oncho and Piryu, saw no future for themselves and fled south. Each founded a kingdom. Oncho's, founded in 18 BCE, according to the story, came to be called Pyeokche. Piryu's did not work out well, so he merged it with his brothers. Oncho expanded his state until he conquered all the Mahan and built its capital along the south banks of the Han River, and his descendants ruled Pyeokche until 660 CE. Here, too, the dates don't correspond historically, since there is no evidence of a Pyeokche state until the 4th century. The first verifiable king was Kyonchoko, who reigned from 346 to 375, and is mentioned in a Chinese document from 372. Some of the story has a grain of truth, though, such as the consolidation of Pyeokche out of the Mahan chiefdoms, and the location of the first capital, Hansung, has been recently discovered by archaeologists at a site in southern Seoul in about the same place indicated by tradition. In 474, as a result of pressure from Goguryeo, the capital was moved further south in the Chungcheong region. The third kingdom, Silla, It merged in the southeast in the Naktong Basin in the 4th century. Tradition holds that it is the oldest of the three kingdoms, founded in 57 BCE among the Jin Han peoples by Pak Hyok Gose. One day, the elders of 6 villages met to discuss forming a kingdom, but could not decide who would be king. While they were wondering this, a strange light shone in the forest, where a white horse was kneeling before a large egg. Out hatched a boy. His body radiated light, and birds and animals danced in his presence. Impressed, who wouldn't be, one of the elders raised him, and at the age of 13, the boy was selected by all 6 to be their king. Pak Hyok Gose chose Lady Aryong, who had been born from the rib of a dragon, as his queen. Together, their little kingdom, Sara Bol, prospered. Food was abundant, and no one locked their doors at night. From Sara Bol emerged the state of Shilla. Here again, modern historical scholarship contradicts tradition, suggesting Shilla was probably the youngest kingdom. There are no historical records of its existence until 377, at any rate, when it and its ruler, King Namul, are first mentioned in Chinese records. Since the legends concerning the founding and early history of these kingdoms come from Shilla sources, it is not surprising that they gave themselves seniority. But the tale does reflect the actual historical formation of Shilla from a small city-state to a large one unifying the Jin Han. The capital of Shilla became Kumsong, later named Kyongchu. The three kingdoms were not the only states on the peninsula. The Pyonghan of the lower Naktong Basin and southeast coast never unified, but evolved into 6 tiny kingdoms, referred to collectively as Kaya. The legend of their founding, first recorded in the 11th century, centered on the sacred Kuchisan, Turtle Mountain, where local chieftains were gathered for a festival. A strange voice was heard from the mountain, and then 6 eggs floated down from the sky and hatched the future rulers of the 6 Kaya states. They matured in only 12 days, and each one founded their own state. The legend holds that this took place in 42 CE, but as with the other foundation stories, the date is probably too early. The Kaya did, however, form a federation that played an important role by exploiting iron deposits and acting as a conduit for trade between Korea and Japan. Archaeological evidence shows they left impressive tombs with displays of artifacts suggesting fairly sophisticated state structures and a prosperous population. Yet the Kaya states were too small to maintain their independence and were conquered and absorbed by Shilla in the 6th century. They did leave behind one legacy, the Kayakum, or Kaya harp, a kind of zither that is the most popular Korean traditional instrument. It is still played by some Koreans in both the North and the South. While it is hard to fully unravel the possible meanings that the magical eggs might have had for ancient Koreans, one thing is clear: the royal families were special. Their miraculous births, precociousness, and skills show they were no ordinary humans, but had a connection with the supernatural world. Even the animals recognized their awesomeness. Who could question their authority? The detail about the turtles is interesting because in other parts of East Asia, turtles have negative associations. They are bad parents who lay their eggs and then abandon them, totally neglecting their Confucian duties to their offspring. In Korea, though, turtles are viewed positively and are depicted in iconography. This is just one small way in which Korea, while part of the larger Chinese-centered East Asian civilization, is also a separate land with its own traditions. Besides these early kingdoms, another possible presence in Korea at this time were the Wa, the ancient people of Western Japan. Japanese histories from the 8th century claim that the Japanese Empress Jingu conquered southern Korea in the 4th century and set up a state called Mimana, administered by a Japanese official. This was later seized upon by Japanese imperialists to justify their annexation of Korea, claiming they were simply reuniting what had once been a single state, Korea and Japan. There is no evidence of Japanese rule in southern Korea, nor of the existence of an Empress Jingu, nor did Japan yet exist. Rather, like Korea, it comprised a number of small states, of which Yamato emerged as the most important. In any event, since they loom so large in the modern Korean imagination and manifest some of the features that characterized later Korean history, let's take a moment to examine each of the three kingdoms in a bit more detail. House warriors of the north, Gokuryo. Gokuryo was the largest of the three kingdoms. At its peak, it covered most of southern Manchuria, almost all of what is now North Korea, and the area around modern-day Seoul. It expanded southward under King Kwanketong, who reigned from 391 to 413. Kwanketong is best known for the description of his military accomplishments inscribed on a large stone erected by his successor the year after he died. It is the oldest written document authored by a Korean, though it's written in Chinese. Kwanketo's successor, Chungsu, whose name appropriately means long-lived, ruled from 413 to 491. Chungsu further expanded the kingdom southward, going deeper into the Korean peninsula. The capital of Gokuryo was located near modern Qian in China on the Yalu River. It is a beautiful setting. Today the ruins are a UNESCO World Heritage Site, but being a bit out of the way are not often visited. Chungsu moved the capital to Pyongyang in 427. This shift in location is important to settling the question of whether Gokuryo was a Korean or Manchurian state, as from this point on its center was firmly planted in Korea. Gokuryo was a warrior state with an aristocracy of mounted archers. When not fighting, they hunted deer, boar, bears, and tigers. As in ancient Sparta, young men from the elite class of this warrior state lived and trained together separately from their families, constituting an institution known as the Chungdang. These young aristocrats were taught to read and write while studying archery and forming bonds of loyalty to one another and to the state. Gokuryo's Central Asian roots are obvious in its customs. The whole mounted archer tradition originated in the steppes, entered Korea via Manchuria, and then was introduced by Koreans to Japan. Aristocrats were buried in elaborate tombs painted with scenes of hunting, horse riding, and archery, as well as dancers and wrestlers. Women are depicted as mixing freely with men. There are also many animals, both real and mythical, dragons, tigers, snakes, and, of course, turtles. The vivid paintings give us a glimpse of a world that seems much more linked to Manchuria, Siberia, and Central Asia than to East Asia. Even their dress looks more Central Asian than Chinese or later Korean clothes. For all its rough, semi-nomadic warrior ways, Gokuryo gradually fell under the influence of China, in large part due to Buddhism. In 372, a Buddhist missionary from China named Sundo converted Gokuryo's leadership to Buddhism, and it was adopted as the state religion. Two centuries later, the kingdom was sending Buddhist missionaries to Japan. One of them, Anyong, was an advisor to the famous prince Shotoku. Among his other achievements, the prince, whose picture used to adorn Japan's currency, is credited with adopting the name Nippon for the emerging Japanese state. The same year, Gokuryo adopted Buddhism, it established a Chinese-style academy in the capital to teach Chinese curriculum to the elite. Today, there is some controversy over just how Korean Gokuryo was. Chinese textbooks today represent it as a Manchurian state affiliated with China, whereas Korean nationalists believe it was part of Korea. Both claims have important geopolitical implications. If it really was an extension of China, does that mean North Korea, too, is part of historical China? Or if the Korean nationalist interpretation is more accurate, does that suggest that much of Manchuria is really part of the Korean homeland? This disputed interpretation remains unresolved and is currently a source of tension between China and the two Koreas. Between China and Japan, Pyeongchae. In the rich agricultural lands of southwest Korea, with its milder, more humid climate, Pyeongchae was a more cultured society than its rougher warrior neighbor to the north. Pyokche served as an intermediary between China and Japan, supplying the latter with monks, scribes, and artisans. Nonetheless, its ruling family claimed Goguryeo origins and ultimately linked their heritage to the ancient Manchurian state of Puya. Like Goguryeo, Pyokche was dominated by warrior aristocrats who wore armor, rode horses, practiced archery, and were buried in tombs. But the art they left behind was more refined and showed greater Chinese influence. The tomb of King Muryong, discovered in 1971, is the greatest surviving example of Pyokche art. It somehow escaped the grave robbers that looted other tombs, and archaeologists found the remains of the king and his queen inside, along with more than 2,900 priceless objects, including their beautiful gold tiaras. Buddhism was brought to Pyokche in 384 by an Indian monk named Marananda. It quickly took hold, at least among the royal family, who were great patrons of the religion and built many temples. They were especially keen on pagodas that came to dot the countryside, two of which survive today. One king, Pap, reigned 599 to 600, became so devout that he banned the killing of all animals and ordered the release of all domestic animals and the destruction of hunting weapons. Not surprisingly, his reign was short. As it had in Goguryeo, Buddhism acted as a conduit for Chinese culture, and Pyokche gradually adopted Chinese bureaucratic institutions and customs. The greatest patron of Buddhism was King Song, 523 to 54, whose name literally means Holy King. He famously sent a mission to Japan that is credited with introducing Buddhism and literacy to that land. In fact, there were many strong links between Pyokche and the emerging state of Yamato. Many of the Pyokche elite are believed to have migrated there and intermarried with the Japanese elite. In fact, the Japanese imperial family today is probably of partial Pyokche ancestry. The bane of Buddhist missionaries, Shilla. The most isolated of the three kingdoms from China and civilization, Shilla was the last to adopt Chinese-style bureaucratic institutions and the last to convert to Buddhism. A number of missionaries attempted to introduce the faith, but came to a bad end. The last in this line of martyrs was Ichadon, who in 527 made a number of predictions about what would happen if he were killed. His prophecies came true. When he was beheaded, the earth shook, his head flew off to land on the top of a nearby sacred mountain, and a tall fountain of milk poured out of his decapitated corpse. This was enough to convince the court and the aristocracy of the power of Buddha, and they converted. Or so the story goes. The Shilla king took the name Po Hung, the rising of the Dharma, built temples, and made Buddhism the state religion. About this time, the state issued a code of administrative law roughly based on the Chinese practices, thus bringing Shilla into the Chinese-centered world in the 6th century. Much of the change was superficial, however. Underneath some new names and forms, it remained a Northeast Asian warrior aristocratic state with strong Manchurian and Siberian characteristics. Kings wore crowns of deer antlers and used jeweled bear claws as symbols of authority, a common practice in the region that was also used by Japanese emperors. Horse riding and archery were the most prized skills of the aristocracy, and shamanism remained an important part of spiritual life. Another link with the Northeast was the bone rank system, a hierarchy of hereditary castes with the sacred bone lineage of the royal family at the top. The very title, along with the origin myths, suggests the semi-divine nature of early kings. There is evidence that they may originally have had some shamanistic role as well. That is, the kings served as spiritual as well as political leaders. In any case, next was the true bone rank of the upper aristocracy, including those that had married into the royal family. Below them were the head ranks, of which the highest, the 6th rank, represented much of the upper aristocracy who served as officials in the state. This rigid system of inherited status would remain a characteristic of Korean society into the 20th century. Representatives of the great aristocratic families were sent to the Wapak, a council that met at four sacred spots near the capital, Kyongchu. The Wapek had the power to decide the succession to the throne and to declare war. It also adjudicated disputes over property among the landowning elite. This, too, would be a long-standing characteristic of Korean society, powerful councils of aristocrats that shared power with the kings. A third institution of Shilla worth noting was the Warang, literally flower boys, a confederation of young unmarried youths much like the elite archers of the Gokuryo. Although the exact function of the Warang is a bit unclear, perhaps a hint can be found in a peculiar story about their origins that was recorded in the 13th century. It relates that the court was looking for talented young people and finally selected two beautiful women. But they grew jealous of one another. Jealous women are a common theme in Korean tales, and one got the other drunk and drowned her in a river. Instead of beautiful women, the court then turned to handsome young men and dressed them up in makeup and fine clothes, which worked out so well that the institution of flower boys was established. Most modern scholars believe the Warang served as a kind of bonding and training to prepare aristocratic youth for service to the state. They were supposed to be totally dedicated to the kingdom. When General Pumil learned that his only son, a Warang, had been killed, he famously proclaimed his regret that he only had one son to sacrifice for his kingdom. In modern times, the Warang became a symbol of patriotism. South Korea's military academy is named after them. All this reflects another characteristic of society, a pattern of shared monarchical and aristocratic rule in pre-modern Korea. Wars and unification. For 2.5 centuries, the three Korean kingdoms fought each other for supremacy. Shilla emerged victorious and unified most of the peninsula. But it was a long process, and it succeeded only with help from China. At first, Gokuryo, by far the largest in territory, was the main contender for supremacy. In 433, Pyeokche and Shilla formed an alliance against the northern power, but this did not stop Gokuryo from taking the Pyeokche capital of Hansong in 475. Pyeokche's King Kaido died in battle, and the fertile Han River basin came under Gokuryo control. In the 6th century, Shilla went on the offensive. It consolidated its position to the south by conquering the small Kaya states and gaining control over the entire Naktong Valley and the southeast coast. Since Kaya had strong links with the emerging Japanese state, this blocked direct Japanese influence in Korea for the next 1,000 years. At the same time, King Chinhong ruled 540-76, under his general Kelchubu, wrested control of the Han River Basin from Gokuryo in a series of campaigns from 551 to 554. He then turned on Shilla's ally of 120 years and inflicted a major military defeat on Pyeokche at the Battle of Gwansan in 554, in which Pyeokche's King Song and 30,000 of his troops perished. Jinhong placed stelae boasting of his successes along strategic passes. These have since been moved to secure locations, but hikers in the mountains of Korea can still see the facsimiles that have replaced them along these scenic spots. For nearly 3 centuries, China was too weak and divided to pay much attention to Korea. This changed when the Sui dynasty from the north reunified China in 589. Not long after, the second Sui ruler, Emperor Yang, began an effort to pacify the frontier regions and to emulate the achievements of the Han by expanding the empire. He subdued the formidable Turks to the northwest, then turned his attention to the northeast. The biggest prize was Gokuryo, but it was the one that he failed to capture. He sent an army of 1,130,000 men into the region, attacking Pyongyang with a force of 300,000. But they were repulsed. Returning, they had to cross the Chungcheon River north of the capital, and there Gokuryo General Ulchi Mundok inflicted a serious defeat on the Sui forces, partly by damming the river and releasing the floodwaters. Of the vast army from China, only 2,700 survived. Still, Emperor Yang did not give up, He sent two more armies in 613 and 614, but both were defeated. These setbacks cost him and his dynasty the throne, and the discredited Sui dynasty was replaced by the Tang. Although undoubtedly exaggerated by Tang chroniclers in order to justify the new dynasty's seizure of power, these were surely huge setbacks for the newly reconstituted empire that the new Tang rulers could not let stand. After once again subduing the Turks, the rulers of the new dynasty turned their attention back to Korea. Tang Emperor Taichung launched an attack against Goguryeo in 645, but was defeated by General Yang Manchun. He tried again in 648 with the same result. Taichung's successor, Emperor Kaochung, carried out two more unsuccessful campaigns. Long supply lines, rugged mountain terrain, and the harsh winters all contributed to Chinese defeats. Even so, Goguryeo's success in repeatedly defeating the full weight of the largest empire in history up to that time is truly impressive. It is not surprising that modern Koreans look back to this era with pride. General U Chi, in particular, later became a Korean national hero, and one of the main streets in Seoul is named after him. While Goguryeo was busy holding off the Chinese Empire, Pyokche and Silla were occupied with fighting each other. Queen Chindok of Silla, ruled 647 to 54, sent her official Kim Chun-chu to seek assistance from every direction. Kim went to Japan, to Goguryeo, as if the court at Pyongyang didn't have enough on its hands, and went twice to China. Considering the dangerous nature of travel at that time, let alone the political risks, this was an impressive feat of diplomatic energy. He had some luck with the Tang, who needed an ally against Goguryeo. To curry favor with them, Kim got the Silla court to adopt Tang dress, encouraged his kingdom to adopt Chinese administrative practices, and even wrote Chinese poetry to the emperor. An alliance developed. The Wabek were so impressed by his achievements that they selected Kim Chun-chu as king in 654, when Queen Jindok left no direct heirs. Tang's plan was to invade Pyokche by sea and conquer it with Silla's help. From there, he would launch a two-sided attack against Goguryeo from the north and south. In 660, Admiral Chu Dinpong sailed his ships up the Kum River into the heart of Pyokche, while Silla forces under General Kim Yushin crossed the Sobek Range, dividing the southeast from the southwest. There, at the Battle of Wangsan Plain, the greatly outnumbered Pyokche forces under General...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.